when we are working with linear regression, or when we are working with in general, it is called as regression. So this is the regression model building equal to beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 plus and so on plus beta k xk. How these beta values are calculated? How do we calculate beta values? The technique that is used for calculation of beta values is OLS technique, ordinary least squares. Immediately after building the model, what do we tend to do? Model building is only half of the job. As a good data scientist, right after model building, we should follow that up with model
validation.
Model validation, that's correct. And what is the model validation measure in regression? What is it?
R square.
R square. And for a good model, the R square value has to be
more than
above
80%.
Immediately after calculating R square, we need to look at another measure called
adjusted
R square. What should be the value of adjusted R square?
Almost R square.
Equal to
almost R square. Same as R square. After that, what do we check for?
P value.
We look whether individual variables are impactful or not. That is decided based on the P value. And what are the industry standards? How do you check whether the variable is
less than 0.05?
Then
impactful.
Impactful.
You should keep such variables. Greater than equal to 0.05, the variable is
non-impactful.
Okay, okay.
Dropped.
What is the next thing that we check for?
VIF.
VIF. Why do we check VIF for? What is the use of it?
Multicollinearity.
What is multicollinearity?
Interdependency between the features.
Features, interdependency between the features. Two features are dependent, or more than two features are dependent. Some features are giving the same information, duplication of information. Two features or two variables giving the same info. Now, based on VIF, how do you pick and choose the variables?
Less than five.
If the VIF is less than five, what do you do? What does that mean? That
independent.
Is independent. Shall we keep them or shall we drop them?
Keep them.
Keep such variables. If VIF is greater than or equal to 5, then what do we do? It means the variable is dependent. So what
drop.
We should do?
Drop.
But can we drop all the variables which are having more than 5 VIF in one shot?
No.
Highest will be preferred.
The first highest we have, then go one by one. I want you to make a note here. Even experienced people are making this mistake. What are they doing? They are checking the VIF and dropping all the variables with more than 5 VIF in one shot. That is wrong. Now tell me one thing, all of you, focus. The concept of R square, the concept and the formula behind adjusted R square, the concept and the formula behind P value, the concept and the formula behind VIF, we learned all this and we practiced in Python. Tomorrow, if you go to R, do you think the concept and the formula and the interpretation of R square, does it change if you go to a different tool?
No.
The concept and the formula behind P value, does it change? Let's say tomorrow, if you're working on regression using SAS, does it change from tool to tool, or maybe SPSS or maybe Weka? You're using a different tool, maybe IBM, some other tool, cloud or something. Do you think these concepts and the formulas, the interpretation, does it change from tool to tool? Or do you think the tool doesn't matter? The concept remains the same. Think about it, all of you. Try to respond. Do you think these concepts change from tool to tool? Or the tool doesn't matter? The tool doesn't matter, isn't it? If tomorrow, if in an interview, somebody asks you that, do you know regression? Will you answer saying, I know only in Python? If you ask in R, I don't know how to build a regression model. Will you say like that? Or will you say, I have practiced in Python. only from Python to R, only the syntax will be different. Once I learn the syntax in R, then I can very easily handle regression. Will you be confidently saying, yes, I can handle any tool? Or will you be saying I can do machine learning or regression only in Python? Tell me. Is it possible?
Can handle any tool.
Isn't it? Will you now, since you know all the step-by-step procedure, from tool to tool, what changes? From SPSS to Python to SAS to R, what does it change? What changes? In Python, we wrote a particular syntax for a particular package. Maybe in R, the syntax will be different, isn't it? But will the formula change, the background formula? Do you think the interpretation of R square changes if you go from R to Python? Does it change?
No.
So will you be confidently saying, yes, I can handle any tool. I just need to learn the syntax. Do you agree with that point? Or do you need to learn regression in Python as well as you need to practice in R as well as in SAS as well as in SPSS? Every tool, is it possible for you to practice in every tool?
No.
So you learn the concepts. This is conceptual understanding. You learn the concept and practice in one tool. For other tools, what you need to say, listen, I have practiced in Python. I'm very confident. And whichever tool that you are going to work on, I just need to learn the basic syntax. I'll be able to handle it. So you agree with that point? You have to be confident in that. Okay. You have to confidently tell the interviewer, the recruiter, that I can handle in any tool, because overall concept understanding, I have it. These are the steps that I have to follow. I know what does R square mean. I know what does R square do. I know how to do the feature selection. I know how to select the variables that are independent. I understand all these concepts. I understand the meaning behind VIF. I understand the value of VIF. If VIF is 1 versus VIF is 10, I understand the difference between them. That is what is required, isn't it? As a data scientist, is it the coding that is expected from you, or do you think the interpretation of this output? What is expected from you? What is your core expectation? Am I looking for you to code for me, or am I looking for you to interpret this output and give me the right result? Tell me, what is the expectation?
Interpretation.
The interpretation of the output, isn't it? Coding, if you do half an hour research on the internet, will you get that code, 2-3 lines of code for regression? Anybody can get that code, isn't it?
Yes.
And we can supply the X data, Y data. But what really matters is the output that you got. Do you have the knowledge to interpret it? Do you understand that? Do you agree with my point that coding is the secondary priority? It's the interpretation, conceptual understanding is the top priority. Do you agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Even within Python, right now we have used, let's say, stats models. Okay. Tomorrow, there is another package. Let's say somebody questions you on sklearn package, or you may have to work on sklearn package. Stats models also does regression. Sklearn also does regression. What does it change from tool to tool? Once again, from tool to tool, from package to package, only syntax changes. We just need to understand the basic syntax. That is it, we'll be able to handle. Just to prove that from tool to tool or from package to package, nothing changes, let us redo the regression. But this time, before even going to the logistic regression, we haven't yet discussed it. Let us recap the regression, redo the regression using a different package now. I want to predict based on age. I want to predict whether the customer purchased, whether he will buy. Let's say the product can be something like insurance or a car loan or something. Any product based on the age. This is the X variable. I want to predict whether the customer will buy or not. I want to predict this. I want to build a regression line. Earlier, what did we use? We have used earlier for doing this job. We have used stats models package. Now the stat models has its own syntax. It gives you the output in a different format. Now we will use sklearn package. This has its own syntax. It will give you the output in its own manner. Now from tool to tool or from package to package, what changes is the syntax. So here is the syntax for sklearn. Import the package lr equal to linear regression. As soon as you write this in the background, y equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x1 and so on, that will be created, beta k xk. Lr dot fit, give the x1, x2, x3 and so on, all those variables, give the x first, then give y next. Earlier in stats models, this was y tilde, x1 plus x2 and plus on xk. This was the syntax in the previous package that we have used. In sklearn, the rule, the package tells you that give me x1 plus x2 plus x3 and so on plus xk. Give me all those k variables. Finally, you give me the target. This is the rule set by sklearn package. We have to follow its rule. Then earlier we used to write model dot summary. Then we used to get a huge summary. But in sklearn, there is no such thing as summary function. LR is the model name. Then we have to write LR.coefficient to get the coefficient, all the beta coefficients. LR.intercept to get the intercept values. In fact, we can write LR.predict. Give the x value, then you will get the predicted value of y. Earlier, we have predicted manually, right? We have supplied 500,000. We have supplied 500,000, $5 lakh, and we predicted 36,000 passengers will come. Something like that, we can directly use LR.predict. Here also, there is a predict function. Here also, there is a predict function, LR.predict. Apply the value of x, you'll get the value of y. What I'm trying to prove here as a whole is from package to package, only syntax changes. We should not be worried that I have not worked on that tool. I have not worked on that package. Will I be able to handle it or not? Don't worry about it. Okay. In future, confidently say yes to any new tool. If the client tells you a tool which you have never heard of also, don't worry about it. Confidently give them the confidence that I can handle it. I know the model building. I know the conceptual. I have the conceptual understanding. Syntax is not a big deal for me. I can learn it. Give me a chance. Okay. Will you be able to confidently say that? I think now you must be very confident. Let us do this exercise. All of us, let's go to logistic regression code file. Here is the logistic regression code file. I'm pasting this link in the chat window. By clicking this link, you will be directly landing here. It's a linear regression recap. We haven't yet started logistic regression. Linear regression recap. What I want you to do is import the data set. Build the model, look at the intercept and coefficient, then get the predicted values. When age is 4, what is the predicted value? When age is 105, what is the predicted value? Finally, give me the predicted values in the chat window, everyone. Age is 4, age is 105, what is the predicted value? For age 4, I'm getting the prediction to be minus 0.0866. For age 105, the prediction is 2.02. Don't go too far ahead. Just stop here. In the code file, do not execute the whole code. I think some of you are already on the same page with me. Whatever discussion we are having here, only until this point, until that point, you execute the code snippets, then wait, okay? Do you have these? Once you're done with this, quickly send me a message. If everyone is on the same page, then I'll proceed with the discussion. Once you're done with it, send me a message. Once everyone is done, then we'll proceed. Okay. Now look at this carefully. We have something called age. The continuous variable. Age can be 2 years, 3 years, or 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years. And we have the target variable, which is a buy. Buying or not buying. Buying or not buying. Let's say 0 means the customer is not buying. 1 means the customer is buying. That is it. We have only two classes in the output. This is X, this is Y. When X is 4, when age is 4, the predicted value is -0.0866. I know the meaning of 0, which means not buying. Please pay attention. We know the meaning of 0, which means not buying. We know the meaning of 1, which means buying. Do we have any meaning of any negative value? Have we ever seen any negative value in the historical data? We have never seen it. Can we simply assume, since it is near to 0, -0.0 something means it is 0 only? Is that a good assumption? Generally, assumptions in real life, are they useful? Can we simply go with blind assumptions without any base? We cannot. There is something wrong here. Age is 105, the predicted value is 2.02. I know the meaning of 0, not buying. I know the meaning of 1, buying. But do we have any class like 2, previously historical data? Nope, we never had anything like that. Historically, we never have seen anything like 2. But now the predicted value is 2. Can I simply assume 2 means buying 2 items? Is that a good assumption? Was there any 2 historically? No, there is no such 2. Something is wrong here as well. We cannot simply assume 2 means to buying 2 items. There's something wrong here. There's something wrong here. Let us investigate it further. Since there are only 2 variables, I can draw the line. I can actually draw the data. On the x-axis, you have age variable. On the y-axis, you have buy. Buying whether 0 or 1. That's it. The target variable y takes only 2 values. Either 0 or 1. Not buying, 1 is buying. It doesn't take any other value. 0.65, 0.82, 0.95, 0.45, 0.23. Nothing like that. Either 0 or 1. Now for this data, for this kind of data, we built a regression line. We built y equal to beta naught plus beta 1x. We built a straight line regression. We built a linear regression line. Do you think a linear regression line, a straight line, can it go through all the points in this data? Is a straight line a good representation of this data? Do you think so? Is it a good representation of the data that is underlined? Definitely, it is not a good representation of the data that is underlined. So definitely, linear regression, a straight line. Straight line regression means linear regression. Straight line regression fails in this case. Fails here for this type of data. A linear regression is not a silver bullet that will work on every kind of data in this world. That is not true. A linear regression fails in the cases where you have this target variable either as 0 or as 1. In those cases, linear regression fails for sure. This is the case where linear regression fails. Is this the only example? Are there any other examples in real life? In sales, when you are predicting whether the customer will buy or not buy, based on the customer features, X1, age of the customer, based on the customer income, X2, based on the customer's gender, based on the customer region, based on the customer expenses, based on the customer monthly utilization, based on all the customer profile details, I want to predict whether the customer will buy or not buy. Again, based on the customer profile details like age, income, gender, region, your his expenses, his monthly utilization, etc. I want to predict whether the customer will respond to my marketing call positively or whether he will not respond. Respond versus not respond. For this type of data also, I cannot use linear regression because finally I'm predicting either 1 or 0. If the customer is going to respond, then only I will make a marketing call. Otherwise, why should I make a marketing call to the customer? It's a waste of time. In credit cards and loans, I want to predict whether the customer will be defaulter. Defaulter means not paying money. Bad customer versus non-defaulter, good customer. Based on all the customer profile details like age, number of loans, number of missed payments, monthly utilization. Based on all the customer financial history, I want to predict whether the customer will end up like a defaulter or non-defaulter before giving a loan. Based on the customer usage data, based on the customer number of complaints, based on the customer number of service plan changes, based on all the customer profile details, usage details, I want to predict whether the customer will act right, churn out, or retain, or whether we stay back. Based on the clickstream data, how many websites you have visited in last 6 months, how much time you have spent on social networking websites, how much time you have spent on news websites, what type of news you are viewing, at what time you are watching all these news. Based on the complete clickstream data, I can get a hell lot of data. I would like to predict whether you will click on this advertisement or not, whether you will click on this ad or not. That's what I want to predict. If you are not going to click on Switzerland holiday package advertisement, do you think is there any use of showing it to you? If there's a high chance for you to click on this mobile phone advertisement, then I'll better show that advertisement to you rather than showing you something which is totally irrelevant. Whenever you swipe one card, with just single swipe, I can get a hell lot of information. What is the amount that you have swiped? How many times you have swiped in this week? What is the average amount, and this amount, how higher or how lower is this amount from that average amount? What is the vendor code? Is it a restaurant? Is it a grocery store? Or is it a different type of store? What is the number of transactions that you have made this week? What is the amount of transaction? What is the time of transaction? What is the place of transaction? Based on all these details, I want to predict whether the transaction is fraudulent or not. That's what I want to predict.
Excuse me, sir. Hello.
Yeah,
we're not able to hear you properly sometimes.
Is it? Everybody is facing the same issue, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let me check the
headphone. And some background sound is.
I have adjusted my microphone. Is it better?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Shall we continue like this?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
So thanks, last sir. 2-3 lines.
Yeah. So can you hear me clearly? Shall we continue like this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What I'm saying is the fraud versus not fraud. Let's say $1, $2, $10, $15 or $100 or $1,000. Will I be interested in predicting the amount of fraud when a swipe happens, or should I be interested in overall predicting whether it is fraud versus no fraud? What do you think is a meaningful model that we should build? When a swipe happens, is it a good model to it? Is it a good idea to predict exact the amount, or is it a good idea to simply classify it as fraud, non-fraud? If there's a chance for a fraud, we'll simply stop it. What do you think companies will be interested in doing?
Fraud and non-fraud.
Isn't it overall fraud and non-fraud? This is much better, isn't it? So there are so many cases in the real world where we will be doing something like this. The prediction will be somewhat like this. This is known as classification. These type of problems are known as classification type of problems. You will be surprised to know 90% of the business applications in the real world, if you go in the real world business cases, 90% of the cases are classification problem cases only. In the real world, people are not really interested in the exact prediction, exact point prediction, like in linear regression that happens, right? Like in linear regression, you can predict the number of passengers, exact point. You can predict the number of users, the exact point. You can predict the loss percentage, the exact point. Usually people are not interested in this. Industry is not interested in this. Industry is interested in overall classification, either this side or this side, whether the customer is buying or not buying, how much amount he is going to spend with us, that we are not yet interested. Most of the cases, 90% of the business cases in the real world are classification type of problems. And for all those classification type of problems, linear straight line regression fails. There has to be some different type of non-linear function that we need to search for. Here are some non-linear functions that are available. There are so many non-linear functions. Our data is of a particular type. Our zeros are here. Our other part of the data is here. When the data is like this for us, what is that particular non-linear function that suits best for solving our type of problem? Tell me.
Exponential.
If you look at exponential, maybe zero is covered. One, it will not cover. This doesn't work. If you look at double exponential, it covers zero. Again, one doesn't cover. So logistic, if you see, this is the best one for our type of problem. The best part of logistic function is it always varies between 0 and 1 only. Minimum value is 0, maximum value is 1. It is always between 0 and 1. Our data is also either at 0 or at 1. So definitely a logistic function is the one that will help us to solve this problem. Instead of building a straight line regression, we will be building this S-curve kind of regression, which is known as logistic function. This type of model building is known as logistic regression. This is not linear regression. This is non-linear logistic regression. Like the way, if the data is like this, you have a straight line, y equal to beta naught plus beta 1 x is the model. There will be an equation for this as well. This is a straight line equation. This is the logistic regression line equation, e power beta naught plus beta 1 x, y equal to e power beta naught plus beta 1 x divided by 1 plus e power beta naught plus beta 1 x. Here also beta naught is intercept, here also beta 1 is coefficient of x, but this one will end up like a straight line, this one will end up like an S curve. This is known as logistic regression line. And for the problems that we discussed, for the classification problems, we need to use logistic regression line. Here is the logistic regression line equation, y equal to e power beta naught plus beta 1 x divided by 1 plus e power plus beta naught plus beta 1 x. So for our problem that we have built a linear regression line earlier, product sales prediction based on the age, if you want to predict whether a customer will buy or not, for this classification problem, we must be using not the linear regression, we must be using logistic regression line. And what is the code for it? Earlier we wrote model equal to linear regression here, but now we have to write my model. Logistic is the model name, equal to logistic regression. That means in the background, y equal to e power divided by 1 plus e power, this will be built. Then supply the x value, then supply the y value. Beta naught and beta 1 will be calculated in this equation, coefficient, intercept. Then now you supply the values of age. Once you use predict function here, there is a high chance for you to get right accuracies here or right accurate predictions here. Go ahead, tell me what are the predicted values when you are using a logistic regression instead of linear regression. Go ahead, all of you. Go to the code file.
Yes, it is between 0 and 1.
So, what we have done here is we first built a linear regression line. Then we saw that there is something wrong. Then we started drawing it. Then we saw that linear regression is not suitable. Then we went on to logistic regression, which worked. Tell me one thing, in real world scenarios, drawing the data, especially when the data is multivariate, is this step possible? Is it possible to draw the data always? Do you think, can you visualize multidimensional data always?
No, sir.
It's not possible. In the real world scenarios, you need to look at the problem statement. All of you, listen to this carefully. You need to look at the problem statement. You need to look at the target variable. Look at the problem statement. Look at the target variable. You must decide whether it is a linear regression problem or whether it is a classification problem that you are going to solve it using logistic regression. You have to have the intuition to just look at the data, look at the problem statement, and decide what type of problem is it. Or what kind of algorithm that I'm going to use? Is it going to be a linear regression problem or is it going to be a case of classification? Let me give you some problem statements. Let me see whether you can guess it correctly or not. All of you go to your chat window. Try to use the chat window, put number one. Tell me whether it's a linear regression problem or is it a classification? Usually linear regression, people don't say like that. People simply say regression. When somebody says regression, they mean to say they are talking about linear regression. That's a general notion. So tell me the first one, number one, is it a regression problem? Is it a classification problem? Try not to use the mouse, mic. Try to use the chat window so that I can understand everybody's output. So the first one is a regression problem. The second one, number two, put number two and tell me what is it. It is a classification problem, which you are going to solve it using logistic regression. Number three. Is a regression problem. Number four. Number four. What is number four? Is a classification problem. Put number five. Number five. Yes, sir. Number five. What is number five? Yes, sir. Regression problem. Number six. Put number six and give me the result. What is number six? It's a regression problem. Number seven. Put number seven and tell me, what do you think is the answer? Number seven is a classification problem. Number eight. Number eight is a classification problem. Number nine, it's a fraud application, detecting fraud or not fraud. So number nine is classification problem. Number 10, since it is a fraud, since it is classification, this is also fraud. So this is also classification, right? Can I say like that? Fraud is classification. AB fraud. So that's why it is classification. Number 10 is classification. Can I simply say always fraud will be classification like that?
No, sir.
No. This is what? What are you predicting? Amount of fraud, which means fraud can be $1, $2, $10, $15, $20, $30, $100, $1,000. It's a huge range. So this is a regression problem. Agreed or not?
Yes.
Will you be able to look at the problem statement in future? Simply by looking at the problem statement, looking at the target variable, will you be able to decide whether it is a regression problem or whether it is a classification problem? Have you got that intuition now?
Yes.
Yeah. Will you be still confused? Yaar, ye to classification hai, regression hai. Will you be confused like that, or can you make that decision clearly? Looking at the target variable, looking at the prediction, you know what I'm predicting this kind of range of values. It is not limited values of zeros and ones that I'm predicting. So this is regression, this is classification. You have to take that call. This is not really a difficult job, but you need to have the basic intuition to get that, whether it is regression or classification. Is there any confusion in future whether it is a classification problem or regression problem while deciding it?
No.
What we will do is we will now learn the steps in this logistic regression. Logistic regression is one of the classification algorithms. In future, we are going to learn a couple of more classification algorithms as well. You consider logistic regression as one of the classification algorithm solution. Okay. Like the way we have simple logistic regression, simple linear regression, and multiple linear regression. Here we have simple logistic regression. Multiple logistic regression is also possible. That is y equal to e power beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 and so on plus beta k xk divided by 1 plus e power beta naught plus beta 1 x1 plus beta 2 x2 and so on plus beta k xk. This is the multiple logistic regression line where multiple variables are used for the prediction of the target. Whether the customer will buy or not buy generally doesn't depend on single factor. There will be multiple features that will depend, and that will help us in predicting the target variable y. This is the multiple logistic regression line equation. And in reality, we will be building these multiple logistic regression line equations. As usual, to understand the nitty-gritties, we will take a case study, and one by one measure, we'll try to understand in that case study and experiment with that case. So the next case study is a very important case study. When you join a company, there is a high chance that you may work on a model like this. This is known as churn prediction model. Churn prediction or customer churn prediction. Have you ever heard of anything like churn prediction? Churn means customer leaving, customer stop using our services, or customer is no more active. Churn means churn out, means the customer left our network or the product or the service. Let us suppose there are 10,000 customers in a portfolio or in a region. By building this model, we will predict that these 8,500 customers, they will stay back. And these 1,500 customers are likely to churn out in next few months. These are the guys, they are going to churn out. That means they are going to leave us. Tell me, what is the use of such model? Right now, all the 10,000 customers are with me. What is the use of knowing that these 1,500 customers are going to churn out? What is the use?
Make them retain.
So what we do is, with these 1,500 customers, we run some strategies called retention strategies. Retention strategies. What are retention strategies? We give them some offers. What is one of the best offer that we can give? Wave off. We are waving off your late payment charges. Wave off 1 month charges. Try to send them some message so that they can come back and stick with us. Because business companies believe that retaining an old customer is easier. Getting a new customer is twice difficult. Do you believe in that? Getting a new customer is difficult rather than retaining an old customer. So companies tend to retain by running these retention strategies. Even when you observe next time, Swiggy, Ola, Uber, these small apps also, Amazon, Flipkart, if they feel that you are going to churn out, they run these churn models every month. If they feel that you are going to churn out, if they feel that they are losing you, they tend to retain you by sending an offer that is exclusively for you. Use this coupon code, come back, use this coupon code, or use this offer, come back, something like that you will receive. Next time, try to observe, have you ever received any retention SMS or any retention offer that is actually applied on you?
Yes.
Yeah. Sometimes, isn't it? Like, we also are the customers for some companies, products and apps. Definitely, we receive retention strategies applied on us, especially when we are in that zone of churnout. Definitely, companies which are tracking customer details, they will be building these models. Some team in their company will be doing it for sure. Then what do we do with these customers who are going to be loyal? These are all loyal. They are not going to churn out. What strategies are applied on these 8,500 customers? We apply cross-selling and upselling strategies. What is cross-selling? If a customer has product A, then we try to sell him product B or C or D. If a customer has Jio SIM card, what do we try to sell him? If he is a loyal customer, we'll try to sell him Jio Fiber, Jio TV, isn't it? Jio Setup Box, all those things. Do you agree with that point? That is called cross-selling. Because these are the guys who are actually with us. We have to squeeze maximum amount of revenue from them. Agreed or not? There is no point in giving offers to these guys. Do you think we should give offers to these guys? They are anyway loyal. Is there any use of giving an offer to them? 1 month wave off, should I give it to them? If a customer is very happy with me, why should I give him 1 month wave off? That will be a loss. And what do we do? If this doesn't work, try to do upselling. What is upselling? If a customer has A, then try to make him 2A or 3A, 4A. The same thing, you try to upgrade. That means if you have an internet service, try to give him an option to upgrade. Have you ever received cross-selling, upselling options? I mean, those strategies applied on you. If you have a savings bank account, take the DMAT account, take the insurance from us, take the loan from us. Have you ever received any cross-selling, upselling strategies or any of those strategies applied on you? Next time, try to observe. Next time, try to observe if you are loyal to something. If you have been a good customer, you will always receive these kind of offers. If you are about to churn out, you will receive these offers behind all the scenes. Behind the scenes, do you think these are random? No. There will be data that is considered. Churn prediction model will be running. Based on that, these strategies are applied. It is not as simple as it sounds. This prediction is made in the background. We are going to take a data set that has been shared by one company, which is Fiberbits, which is an internet service provider company. What did they do? They have gathered the data from 1 lakh customers. They have waited for 2 years. This is last 2 years' data. They have gathered the data of 1 lakh customers. and what did they record at the end of 2 years, whether the customer is active or inactive. Inactive means these are the guys who churned out. These are the guys who are active at the end of 2 years. This is my target, active underscore cust, which takes two values, 0 or 1. Active underscore cust. At the end of 2 years, whether the customer is still active, good. If the customer is inactive, if the customer is gone, churned out. And these are the features. This is my target. I want to predict this. And what are the features? I have the customer income, customer months or network, customer number of complaints. Do you think number of complaints has anything to do with attrition? Does attrition depend on number of complaints? Or it has nothing to do? It doesn't have any impact.
Yes.
If there are more complaints, what happens?
Customer may go.
Yeah, that is a good indicator that there is will be higher attrition, isn't it? Number of service plan changes. A customer is frequently changing the plan. Customer relocated. Maybe he might stop using on it. Customer monthly bill, technical issues, speed test results. Like that, they have gathered X1, X2, X3, and so on, X8, all these variables. This is the data set that we have. Tell me one thing. I have this data, that's all right. I have these features, that's all right. But I already know who is active. I already know who is churned out. What is the need of the model? Why the hell I use this model? Already this is 2 years back data. By the end of 2 years, I know who is active, who is churned out. What is the use of this model?
So for that,
I can use this model on a fresh set of customers which are with me, isn't it? This is 2 years back data. But now I have these customers. For those customers which are right now with me, do I know their estimated income? Yes. Can I get this months on network? For the existing customers right now who are with me? Tell me, can I get this data? Months on network?
Yes.
That means how many months they have been. Can I get the number of complaints? Will I be tracking all the number of complaints? How many times they have changed the service plan? Can I track that? Relocation request they have raised or not? Can I get that? Monthly bill, can I get that? Technical issues from our side, can I get that? Speed test. All of these I can get that using that on the current data. Using this on this current data, I can predict in the next few years or in the next few months what this customer is going to do. That I can predict. That is where I can use this model. Model building is not really to learn what has happened here. This is to predict what is going to happen. That's why we are going to build this model. And for this type of data, which model are you going to prefer without any doubt?
Logistic
regression. It's a classification problem. And the only algorithm that we know as of now is logistic regression. So we are going to use logistic regression. It is a clear case. Or will there be any confusion that shall I go with regression or shall I go with logistic? Or do I need to draw the data and decide that? Is there any doubt in that before choosing logistic regression? There should be no doubt because the output is either 0 or 1. Clear case of classification. We'll go ahead with logistic regression model building. My model equal to logistic regression. Model dot fit x1 plus x2 plus x3 plus x4 and so on plus xk. Supply all the k variables. This is not a literal summation. This is a way to tell Python that these are all my X features. Use them for model building. And this is my target variable Y. This is using which package? Sklearn package. I'm also going to give you stats models package as well. Both of them can do linear regression and logistic regression. Usually I prefer the first package, which is stats models. Why I prefer that? Because it gives a huge summary and I always like a detailed summary. Sklearn also calculates everything, but it keeps it in a model object. We have to get one by one, everything on our own. So usually my suggestion to you is learn both of them. But if you have a preference, if you have any chance, try to use stats models. Okay. Both of them will give you the same results. Okay. Only thing is the output format is slightly different. SKLearn doesn't give a good formatted result. Stats models gives you good summary. Maybe in future in this package, summary report is also added. Then we can prefer any one of those two. At the end of this, the model will be built. Everything will be stored in this logistic one model object. You can get logistic one underscore intercept to get the intercept value, beta naught value. You can write logistic one underscore coefficients to get the beta one, beta two, and so on, beta k coefficient values. Once you have these beta coefficients, that is the end of model building. But right after model building, will I be celebrating? Will I be going for the predictions? Or as a good data scientist, what should I follow that up with? Model building must be always followed by
validation.
Model validation, without any doubt. The respect of the model will increase or decrease based on the model's accuracy only. Anybody can build a model. Any feature can be used for prediction. What really matters is how good is the model. That's what matters. How good is the logistic regression line? That's what matters, isn't it? Earlier in linear regression, how did we validate the models? We looked at sum of squares of regression divided by sum of squares of total, which is R square. We used R square. Here, there's a different measure that need to be used because these are classification models. So here is what we are going to do to calculate whether this model is a good model or not. Take x1, x2, and so on, xk data, first of all. Take y actual data. What are y actual values? Tell me, what are y actual values? Zeros and ones only. Do you agree? Y actual values are zeros and ones only. Now, once you have this data, once you have built the model, can you use model.predict function? Can you supply X data? Can you get the Y predicted data? Have you tried getting Y predicted values earlier? Have you supplied age 4? Have you got the predicted value by using model.predict? Have you supplied age 105? Got the predicted value. Similarly, I can supply the X values. Can I get the predicted values? Yeah. So similarly, actual values are there. Tell me, acknowledge that point. Have you understood how predicted values are calculated? I'll supply the first row X values to the model. I'll use model.predict. Can I get Y predicted value? Any doubt in that? Getting the Y predicted value? Have you understood that? How do we get it? Supply the X data in the first row. Get the values from the model.predict. You will get the Y predicted values. Is it clear, everyone? Getting the predicted value, is that clear? Are you with me, everyone?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So the Y prediction values will be also zeros and ones only, isn't it? These are the actual values. These are the predicted values. The predictions will also be zeros and ones only. Agreed or not? Now, once you have these actuals, which are zeros and ones, once you have these predictions, which are zeros and ones, then what you do is you create a matrix. Y actual, which are zeros and ones. Y predicted, which are zeros and ones. Imagine this itself is your data. Imagine this small data itself is your data. Actually, how many times when actual value is zero, the model also rightly predicted it to be zero? How many times did that happen in your data? Can you count them and let me know? Zero was truly rightly predicted as zero. How many times did that happen? Zero has been predicted as zero. How many times? Count it. One, two, 3. There are 4 occasions where 0 has been predicted as 0. Is it a good job by the model? Model is doing a good job. Actual value is 0. Model also predicting it is 0. Pretty good. What is also a good job by the model? Actual value is 1. Model is also predicting it to be 1. The actual class is 1. The prediction is also to be 1 only. How many times did that happen?
4 times.
4 times.
1, 2, 3, 4. There are 4 occasions. 1 also has been predicted as 1. Good job. Good job. How many times? The actual value is 0, but the model has made a mistake. It has predicted 0 as 1 by mistake. That's a wrong prediction by the model. How many times did that happen?
One time.
One occasion where model has predicted 0 as 1. How many times 1 has been predicted as 0? That is also a mistake by the model. Wrong job. One as you. Is there any such case? Yes.
Yes, one case.
Yeah. There's one case where 1 is predicted as 0. So overall, how many predictions the model has made? Complete overall number of predictions.
5.
Overall.
Ten.
How many data points are there?
10.
Overall 10.
10 data points are there. Out of them, how many are accurate predictions by your model?
8.
8 are accurate predictions by the model. So what is overall accuracy of the model then?
80%
is the accuracy of the model. This matrix, which compares actual classes with predicted classes, is known as confusion matrix. What is this matrix? Confusion matrix, where actuals and predictors are compared. From confusion matrix, by adding these two, which are right predictions divided by overall, is known as the accuracy. This plus this divided by overall number of records. So to validate the classification models, we have to create confusion matrix. From there, we need to derive accuracy. Sometimes this 0 is known as positive, 1 is known as negative class, 0 is known as positive class, 1 is known as negative class. Predicting positive as positive is known as true positive. Predicting negative as negative, what will be this? Negatives are predicted as negatives.
True negatives.
Positives are falsely predicted as negatives. These positives are falsely predicted as negatives. False negatives. Positives are falsely predicted as negatives. You are calling them. These are the predictions. What are you calling them as? Negatives. But originally they are positives. So these are false negatives. Originally some things are negatives. You are falsely calling them as positives. These are?
False positives.
So sometimes you may hear this type of terminology also. Or 0 as 0, 1 as 1, fraud as fraud, non-fraud as non-fraud. That is even a better, clear explanation. So you have to create this confusion matrix. From there, we need to find the accuracy. Go ahead, go to your code file. Build the logistic regression model. Sometimes when you are building this model, you may get some warnings, but those are not necessarily errors. You can ignore those warnings. The model will be built. Look at the intercept, look at the coefficient, follow it up with confusion matrix and accuracy. Finally, tell me what is the accuracy of your model. All right. We'll pause here and take the questions now. Any questions on whatever we discussed until now? We are not yet done. There are a few more aspects that are still left within this logistic regression. Are there any questions, anyone, on any of these, whatever we discussed until now?
Sir, here if we use stat models, then how different that will be to interpret?
Different in the sense?
In terms of interpretation, like how we can interpret confusion matrix.
It will be the same. No difference will be there. From package to package, the interpretation of the output doesn't change. The meaning doesn't change. Only the output format changes. That's it. There will be absolutely no difference from the interpretation of the interpretation point of view. Okay. Here, you are getting, you are printing the beta naught and beta one values. They will come in a list format. There, they will come in a tabular format. That is the only difference. Okay. Output format will be different, but the confusion matrix, let's say if 80% means 80% are accurate predictions here, 85%. There also, it will be 85%, 85% are accurate predictions like that. Okay.
Okay, so there only we will get the confusion matrix. No other matrices will be
printed. Beta naught, beta one, all that will be printed. The summary table will come as the output. In fact, after 2-3 code snippets, we will also actually use using stats models for logistication. That also we will see in the upcoming slides.
Sir, one more doubt.
Yeah, please go ahead.
The regression line equation, the model that we build, can it be applied to any data set? Any data, any kind of data we have?
You mean to say the logistic regression or the linear regression?
The linear one, first of all.
But the only thing is the features that we are entering, they have to be numeric in nature.
Okay. Yes. And the logistic one?
For the output where it is classification 0 or 1, we can apply.
Okay.
Yeah. What happens is application, we can apply it on anything. But if the data is not really the right fit for this type of model, the accuracy will be going down. Even for the classification, can I apply linear regression? Think about it. If the output is 0 and 1, 0 and 1, if I go ahead, build a linear regression, will I get any error in Python? Think about it. This is the data that I have, and I applied linear regression for this. Will I get any error in Python? Will the Python throw an error saying this is a classification problem? You're applying linear regression. This is wrong. Will you get such error?
No.
You will not get error. The model will be built.
Yeah.
But what will be the problem with that model?
Wrong one.
It will be wrong one means?
It won't.
How will you realize the model is wrong? How will you realize that?
Sir, bad fitting.
Bad fitting means at the end of the day, the accuracy of the model when you validate, isn't it?
Yeah.
And you validate, you will have very low accuracy. Yes or no?
Yes.
That is where the model validation is the one that will tell you the answer to the question, is this model right one? Can I apply this model to this data? It's not really the, you know, judgmental call that we'll take. Even with this, the model will be built. In the model validation, it will fail utterly. Okay.
Okay. So we should check on the kind of data we are feeding.
Mm-hmm, correct. So the kind of examples that we have seen, even before you go to the model building, we have to make a call. We have to take a call. What is the right model? Choosing the optimal model or choosing the right model building technique is also a skill data scientists should adopt. But that comes with intuition. At least between linear regression, logistication, all of you are clear, right? Forget about other models in this world. Between linear and logistic, is there any confusion that you will be facing in future? When to use which model? So as and when I'm introducing new algorithms, I'll bring the same amount of clarity in which scenario I should go with this model building technique. Okay.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir, one basic question here. So once we prepared the data, and we have prepared all this model. The later part, there is any chance to refresh this data after data was prepared? Is there is any chance we have any overview like that, or any scope on that?
Come again, what is the question?
So once we prepared all this data, okay, so is there is any timeline, or so once we completed all these steps and everything, so there is a chance, right, the data would be refreshed on every month or
okay
every
now year. I understood your question. Let's say it is 2015. Suppose I have built a credit risk model, okay, which is used for the prediction whether a customer will pay back or not. This credit risk model gave around 90% accuracy, let's suppose. Now you're asking the question, in 2016, can I use the same credit risk model or not? What I'll do is, right now I have 1 year data. On this new data, I'll apply this model, I'll look at the accuracy. If the accuracy is 89%, do you think I'm going to spend around 3 months of time in building the new model, or do you think we will go ahead with the same model? What do you think is the general process that may, just try to make a guess, may not be correct answer always. What do you think the business will do?
We should go with the same.
Generally, model. We go ahead with the 89, 90 to 89 is not a huge drop, isn't it?
Yes.
Let us suppose you went to 2017. That is again the same credit risk model. This time the accuracy is around 88%. Then also we will go ahead because it is good, accurate enough. But when I go to 2018, the model was built in 2015, but now it is 2018. When I use the same credit risk model on the last 1 year data, the accuracy is 80% only. From 90% at the development time to 80% currently, is this a negligible drop, or do you think it is a significant drop? From 90, when do we say significant? What are the significant points in the general business that we discussed? How many points is considered as a significant gap?
Five
points or more? Is it more than 5 points?
Yes,
definitely yes. So here we have two options. Either re-estimate the coefficients, which means you have x1, x2, x3, and so on, xk features, right? x1, x2, x3, and so on, xk features that were used in model building. Let us suppose you built a logistic regression line to predict whether the customer is bad or good customer. The beta coefficients of x1, maybe the weightage need to be changed, maybe the beta coefficients need to be changed. That means use the same features with the latest data, re-estimate, that means rebuild the model with the same features. Then sometimes you may get better accuracy with this new data by changing the coefficients, by building the model on this new data with the same features. You may bring that accuracy back to around 87 or 88%, then proceed with this. Sometimes even by changing these coefficients, the model will not increase in its accuracy. Then what we need to do? Rebuild. Rebuilding means don't use the same features. Try to find what are the impactful features. Try to start from the beginning, rebuild from scratch. This happens when the population, when the patterns in the populations change totally. Totally, when the patterns in the populations, when they change, then we may have to rebuild. When I was working in Citibank at 2008 or 2009, there was nothing like payment wallet system. Do you agree? A decade back, there was no payment wallet. PayPal was there, but nobody was using it. There was no UPI transaction or anything. But if you go back from last 2-3 years, ever since the demonetization happened, there are so many transactions on payment wallet, Paytm, Google Pay, Phone Pay. Do you agree with the fact that more than bank transactions, nowadays payment wallet transactions are happening? Do you agree with that point?
Yes,
so
yes.
At that time, while we are building the model, we did not consider any payment wallet related transactions. Even in 2015, 2016, 2017, we did not consider. But when I come to 2018, demonetization happened during that time. Don't you think I have to bring in these variables. Because of them only the population has changed. I have to assess the risk associated with the customer. Don't you think I have to bring in payment wallet related transaction? How much amount you have spent on payment wallet? How many transactions you have made? How much you have spent on e-commerce website? Don't you think I have to bring all those variables? Don't you think that will help me in predicting whether the customer is good or bad? Yes or no? Sometimes the population patterns change. That is why once you build the model every year or every 6 months, there will be a cycle, fixed cycle. You keep on revalidating them. If the model accuracy deteriorates drastically, then you may have to reestimate. Sometimes reestimation keeping the same variables works. Sometimes you may have to rebuild. That is the process. The team that takes care of this, generally there will be a team. In Citibank, we used to call it as model monitoring team, MMT team. And in some companies, it is known as stress testing team. Different names will be there. One team will take care of all this model management.
So sir, MMT team and model building team, are they same or different usually?
It depends, yaar. Aisa nahi ki matlab in every company they have to follow the same rule. Aisa nahi hai, okay? That, see that as a role, and team structure can be anything, okay? We don't need to really worry about those particulars. Do you agree?
Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. Sir, one more in general question, sir. Sir, how much time does it take to build a model?
So there are so many functions. Let me repeat the same answer that we discussed yesterday. Do you remember that? There are so many industries, so many functions, isn't it? And the model building time that takes in healthcare is different from e-commerce, from different from banking, different in insurance, different in finance, different in, let's say, automobile. Do you agree with that point?
Yes, sir.
So there is nothing like in market within these marketing teams and risk teams, operation teams, they have different problem statements, isn't it? It all depends on what function we are working with, what data we have, what is the output and what is its impact on the final business. It changes from team to team, problem to problem. I can give you 2-3 examples based on what I have worked on. I worked on marketing. Marketing models are build and dump models. We used to take around 1 month time, around 1 or 2 analysts. Okay. Right now they are called as data scientists. And the credit risk model, that used to take around 3 months time roughly. I used to build a model for Sears portfolio. Citibank used to have a co-brand credit card. So that used to take around 3 months time for around 3 risk analysts like that. Okay. But I cannot really say that every credit risk model in this world has to take this much time. Every marketing model has to take this much time. So if you get these kind of questions, I'm sure you must be thinking from the interview point of view.
Yes,
sir. Be bold though. Theek hai?
Oh, okay, sir.
Bolega, confidence se bolega, right?
Yes.
Isn't it? Or yes. Will he say, ki, yaar, it's only, it has to take 3 months only. Can somebody argue like that? No. You can say, like, this is how much time we have taken. Okay. Maybe 1-3 months time. You can give them. Okay. We took around 2.5 months or 3 months or 1 month like that. Depend. The data was very complex. We had to go a lot of 2 and 4. You can say anything there. Because at the end of the day, that knowledge doesn't matter when I am hiring you, isn't it?
Yes.
How much time does it take to build a model? That doesn't matter. But the knowledge, what is the difference between R square adjusted R square? That is standard knowledge that you must have it, isn't it?
Yes.
So focus on that skill. The remaining things you can confidently manage anything. Okay?
Yes, sir. Sir, one of more type of question that is asked during the interview is that how much data do we put use for model building? So does it have any standard answer?
No, there is no standard. You okay. Just tell them that I have used, let's say, 30,000 rows, or in this data set we have used 1 million rows. You can just, like, at the end I'm going to tell you what projects you are going to put on your CV. Okay. And for that CV, you have to be prepared with all these answers even before you start the interview. You have to take your own CV. You have to take your own project and put that project, write down 30 questions that can be asked by looking at that project. Okay.
Okay.
And be ready with the answers and be confident in that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Because if someone says we have used 50,000 rows and somebody told we have used 1 million rows, someone told we have used only 100 rows. Is there a right or wrong answer in this?
No, sir.
There is no right or wrong answer. 100 rows, because it's a commercial portfolio. There are only 100, like every customer is a very big customer. So 100 rows only possible. 50,000, it can be any answer. Only thing is, we just need to tell them we have to. Basically, I'm going to give you some project assignments. When you do those projects, you can actually put those projects as your actual work experience. And based on that, you can answer. Okay.
Okay.
Sir, just another generic question. Like, do we use like a regression model here only in banking sector or in retail sector like that? Is there anything like
that? Nothing like that. Everywhere, wherever there is data. Okay. Wherever there is a target.
No, standard follows.
Okay. Yes, wherever there is a target, wherever there are features that can be predicted. Let us suppose I go to healthcare and I have some target and there are some features that can be predicted. Shall I say that this is regression model, it is reserved only for banking, I should not use in healthcare? Does it make any sense? Think about
no.
it. So wherever there
based
is
on
something,
the data.
Wherever there is a data which can be predictable, if you have a target, I'm just thinking, like, I want you to discuss and I want you to understand on your own. What do you think? Whichever is the industry, even in a classroom, if you want to predict a student marks, okay, and based on his past performance, if I want to predict there are some features and there is something like target, will you be able to predict the marks if you have sufficient data? Think about it. Is it possible? If you have the data, if there are features, we can use it anywhere. Okay. There is nothing like
yes.
we have to use in a particular sector only. Okay.
Sir, if we have an enterprise level sales with some industrial and automotive products, and we have got an ample number of distributors and suppliers. So for our next sales, if I want to predict that to which supplier or which distributor should I give the budget for? So is it possible by any of these?
Yes, possible. But for that, first we have to convert this particular discussion into a problem statement. Okay. From the data point of view, you have to come up with the target variable. This is just the unstructured problem statement, isn't it?
Yes.
Right now, whatever. You have to give it a structure. You have to tell, this is my target. According to this problem statement, this is my target. According to this problem statement, these are my features which have the ability to predict the target. Giving this structure requires a little bit of knowledge. Maybe these features are available or maybe these are not available. Once you give the structure, then solving it will be a piece of cake. The difficult part here will be giving the structure to this unstructured problem statement.
So whenever we receive any scenarios, we receive an unstructured form.
Yes,
right?
Yes. We have to use our knowledge and we have to come up with this one. This one cannot be trained. This is the creativity. Do you agree with that point? Like, depending on the business, it changes, isn't it? From business to business, the problem that is underlined, that we need to actually learn that skill. So for that, we need to have the good knowledge of the underlying business. Okay. Let's say if I am totally, my work experience is totally on banking. If I have nothing, no understanding of these vendors and no understanding of these sales and all that, then it will be difficult for me. From the beginning itself, I am in this one. Maybe within two iterations, I'll be able to create this. Yeah. So try to give a structure first, then it will be a very easy task. I think you must be trying to solve this particular problem. So next time, like from here on, try to start thinking about giving it a structure. Okay. Does it make sense? Do you agree with my discussion here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All right, then let's proceed. Do you remember multicollinearity? What is multicollinearity? We discussed multicollinearity in regression,
yeah,
where the target variable is either zero or where the target variable is continuous in a range. We try to predict by using x1, x2, x3, and so on, xk. What is multicollinearity there? The
same
interdependency. Yes, the same information can be seen in several features. Interdependency, yes, between the features. Two, three variables giving the same information, duplication of the information. Though they are two variables, but they are actually eventually contributing to one dimension only. That is multicollinearity, interdependency between the features. When there is multicollinearity, I cannot really trust the beta coefficients in linear regression. When you go to logistic regression, that is also y, but this y is 0 and 1. Using x1, x2, and so on, xk features, I am predicting the target variable y. Tell me, from linear to logistic regression, where is the major difference? Is it in the system of x variables or is it in the system of y variables? From linear to logistic regression, where is the major difference? System of x variables is almost same. Y is the one that has changed a lot. But when it comes to multicollinearity, will I be really worried about y? Multicollinearity is something that is associated with only features. So the problem that is there here is also a problem here when you have multicollinearity. If two variables giving the same information, even in logistic regression, that is an issue. Two variables giving the duplication of the information, logistic regression also, that is the issue. Even in logistic regression, you cannot trust the beta coefficients. If two variables are giving the same information, if multicollinearity exists, even in logistic regression, there is a problem. But the lucky point here is the process of detecting multicollinearity here, the process of detecting multicollinearity here, it doesn't change. It's exactly the same because there is no scope of y variable here. So this process of detecting multicollinearity is exactly changed. It's exactly same. How do you detect multicollinearity? The detection, what is the measure that we use? To detect multicollinearity, we use VIF, calculate the VIF value, VIF less than 5, keep such variables greater than or equal to 5, drop such variables, which is a clear case of multicollinearity. So multicollinearity, we have discussed in depth in regression session last time. The same concept without even any change will exactly be applied here. Because yesterday we never talked about target variable y when we are talking about multicollinearity. Only target variable changed, everything else remained the same. Multicollinearity detection exactly remains the same. You have now, I think, 7 or 8 variables in the data. You have 8 variables, x1, x2, x8. From these 8 features, I would like you to calculate multicollinearity among these 8 features. Within these 8 features, calculate the multicollinearity. And let me know, is there any feature that is having more than 5 VIF, which is a clear case of multicollinearity? Is there anything like that?
Number of plan changes, number of technical.
So there are 2 variables. That's the information that I got. Number of plan changes. Plan
technical
changes, which is having around 11.98. Another one is technical issues per month. That is having 11.44. Both of them have more than 5 VIF. So we'll be dropping these 2 variables. We'll be left with 6 features. That's right. Is that what we're going to do?
We need to drop plan.
No, this is not what we must be doing. If 2 variables have more than 5 VIF, dropping both of them, we will lose the information present in that dimension. So what we must do? Drop all the variables
and
have highest VIF. So you remember that. Perfect. So we are going to drop number of plan changes. You will be left with 7 features. can I assume that all these seven will be now definitely independent, or do we need to recalculate and check?
We
have to recalculate and check. Go ahead, recalculate and check that. All of them have
less than 5.
Less than 5 VIF. All the seven features are independent. All the seven features are independent. Yes. Does that mean all of them are impactful? That means independence means Xi versus Xj, all these are carrying independent information. Does that mean every variable, all these seven features will be impactful on the Y, they deserve to be in the model?
We need to check a p-value.
We cannot guess that by looking at VIF, isn't it? VIF is a different story altogether. VIF tells you whether X is independent of X or not. But does it tell you whether X depends on Y or not? Does VIF promise you that all these features will be impactful? Does it promise any impact, X versus Y? Is there any role of VIF in this one? How do you get to know whether these features are impactful or not?
Calculating
p-value.
We look at the p-value. So there is a calculation behind p-value. I told you that the exact calculation, we will not be able to go through it. But behind the scenes, when we looked at the individual impact of the variables, we got the p-value. There was a different test. Some t-test was done. Here there is a different test, some Z test will be done. Eventually that will end up like a p-value. The definition and the interpretation of the p-value remains the same. And how do you interpret p-value and how do you pick and choose the variables?
Less than
0.05, then?
Impactful.
We'll keep.
That variable is impactful. We must keep such variables. If it is greater than 0.05, then?
Non-impactful.
Not impactful. Now to calculate the p-values, will you again start with 8 features or do you ignore that one feature and take 7 features because anyway we dropped that? What do you think we must do? Yeah,
7.
We don't really care about that one feature we dropped, isn't it? That should not be in the model. So there is no discussion. So we, among these 7 features, tell me, is there any feature that is having
monthly.
So from monthly 8. From 8, we came to 8 features. We came down to 7 features based on VIF. Now, based on p-value, which variable has a higher p-value, more than 0.05?
Monthly bill.
Has a p-value of 0.307, which is obviously greater than 0.05. You will say, you'll drop monthly bill, you will use these 6 features. So finally, we need these 6 features, and I'm asking you 2 questions. Are all these 6 features independent of each other? Is there any duplication of information in these 6 features?
No duplication.
How are you so sure? You got to know that by looking at the VIF values and all that. Are all these 6 features impactful or not?
Yes, impactful.
So either you can look at the p-value first, then go to VIF, or you look at VIF first, then go to p-value, there will be no difference. It doesn't really matter which one is first, which one is next. These are the 6 features, let's say X1, X2, X3, X4, X5, X6. These are the 6 features that are all impactful. Now there is one extra measure that you may use or you may ignore this. There's one extra measure that is possible only in logistic regression. Such measure does not exist in linear regression. That within these 6, if I have to write down what are the top 2 features, or within these 6, what is the topmost feature? If I want to rank order, all these 6 are impactful. I agree. But within these, if I have limited budget, I want to focus only on 1 or 2 features. What is the top most impactful feature? Let's say X2 is the top most impactful, followed by X5. Rest of them will come here. These are the top 2 impactful features. If you want to reduce attrition, if you want to see immediate impact on target variable Y, spend the money on these 2 features. These are the top 2 most impactful. If you want to rank order the variables based on the impact, rank ordering the variables based on the impact. This is one extra output if you want to give. You can look at something called Wald chi-square value. Wald chi-square value. Some features are positively impactful. Some features are negatively impactful. Impact is impact. Wald chi-square doesn't really focus on the sign. Wald chi-square will tell you whether a feature is positively impactful or negatively impactful, doesn't matter. But whether it is impactful or not, what is the most impact? Which variable is most impactful? Which variable is least impactful? It will rank order. Wald chi-square will not be there in the output. You can estimate it by looking at the z-square value. So look at the z-square value out of these six features. Tell me top one, the first one. Tell me the second one, top two. What is the first variable? What is the second variable? What are the...
Sir, which one is z-square?
Z-square is Wald chi-square. Do you have z value in the output?
Yes.
Yeah. Usse z-square calculate kar lo.
Oh.
One. So top one, which one is the first variable? Which
number
is
of complaints.
Second variable. First variable is number of complaints.
Speed test region.
Complaints is the first variable. What is the second most impactful variable?
Speed test region.
Yeah. Second most impactful variable is?
Speed test
result. Speed test result. Is that correct?
That was a negative.
But it will be positive after squaring up.
Yes.
So sometimes what happens, the sign depends on the type of the variable. Think about it. If the number of complaints increase, what happens to attrition? If the number of complaints increase, what happens to attrition? It will increase, isn't it? If number of complaints decrease, what happens to attrition?
It
will decrease. That is why it has a positive.
Directly.
But what happens if the speed test is high? If the speed is high, what happens to attrition? If you are giving good speed, what happens to attrition?
Decrease.
If the speed is low, you are giving slow internet. Then what happens to attrition? Increases. So it's an inversely relation. Does that mean negative sign is always a bad sign? Negative sign or positive sign depends on the type of the variable and its relation with the target. Do you agree with that? Think about it.
Yes, sir.
Negative or positive sign depends on the type of the variable. What we are really focusing on is what is the impact, whether it is positive or negative. Number of complaints is the most impactful. We can tell the business guys, if you want to reduce attrition, first focus on how do you reduce the number of complaints, increase the field engineers, resolve the issues quickly. Maybe take these suggestions when you are building the strategies. Number two, if you want to reduce the attrition, focus on giving better speed. Yes, if you improve all the six features, if you improve everything, attrition will reduce. But if you have limited budgets, let's take these two as the top two impacts. By doing so, you will be able to give additional input to the business. This is just an extra. It is not really part of the model building. This is just one extra measure that we can use. Okay. Let us write down once again all the steps in logistic regression model building. Then we will be taking the final questions. In which scenario do you even come to logistic regression? Tell me. In which scenario do you even come to logistic? In the scenario when?
Yes, when no, the, kind of.
When the output is? What is that called?
Classification.
It is not continuous. Number two, build the model. Build the model by using, when you are building the first model, are you going to pick and choose features or are you going to use all the features?
All the features.
All the features is a very good idea, always. Right after building the model building is only half of the job. follow that up with model
validation.
Model validation using confusion matrix and accuracy. After that, what do? Once you have a good model which is giving you above 80% accuracy, then what do?
Check
the
collinearity.
Multicollinearity using VIF. Choose the variables that have less than 5 VIF. Keep them. Greater than or equal to 5 VIF. Drop them. But while dropping, we need to be careful. Will you drop everything?
No.
Highest sequentially. What do you do next?
P-value.
Check the p-value. That will tell you which are impactful, which are not impactful. P-value less than 0.05. Keep them. They are impactful. Greater than or equal to 0.05. Drop them. They are not impactful. What else we do? There is one thing extra that we can do. What is it?
Z-square.
We can look at, we can rank order the features. Rank order the features based on impact by looking at the world chi-square value. Do you get world chi-square value directly in the output or do you need to calculate on your own?
You have to take the z-square.
These are the steps. First 5 steps you must follow while building the logistic regression. Like 6th step is optional. These are the model building steps in logistic regression. But will you directly jump on to model building? Are there any other phases before coming to model building? The phases of coming up with the problem statement, isn't it? Having a clear goal, having a clear objective, defining the problem statement. Right now we discussed, isn't it? This itself is a task. Do you agree with me? It's a creative task. Once you have a clear idea on what we are going to do, go to data exploration, do the data collection, data exploration, validation, data cleaning, then you come to the model building. Okay. So that is with the logistic regression. Any questions, anybody?
Sir, one clarification, sir. So here there is no R square we are checking. So as here output is not there. So when we use stat model, do we need to check the R square also?
No. There is no concept of R square. This is classification. R square doesn't make any sense here. In the output, you may get pseudo R square or something. Nobody uses in the practical scenarios. Okay. There are so many measures. We generally ignore the ones that are not useful. You can only get the accuracy by using the confusion matrix. There are other measures as well, but a continuous output, there only R square makes sense. Any other form of R square, it doesn't make sense in the classification.
Sir, how many types of models are there?
Around 50 different types of models are. So you put yourself in the shoes of a data scientist who is 3 to 4 years experience. Okay. A data scientist who worked in data science. Let's say if you have worked in Citibank for 2 years, like me, and worked in some other company for 2 years, whatever experience that you gain in that, only that I'll be able to give you. आपको कंप्लीट 100% डेटा साइंटिस्ट मैं नहीं बना पाऊंगा. व्हाई? बिकॉज़ आई एम मायसेल्फ नॉट अ 100% डेटा साइंटिस्ट. नो, बिकॉज़ इन 3-4 इयर्स इज इट पॉसिबल फॉर अ डेटा साइंटिस्ट टू वर्क ऑन ऑल द 50 टाइप ऑफ मॉडल्स?
नो सर.
सो विल थिंक प्रैक्टिकली. तो व्हाट यू विल से इज आई नो ओनली दीस टेक्निक्स. बियॉन्ड दिस आई नेवर गॉट अ चांस टू वर्क ऑन देम. आई कैन लर्न एंड आई कैन इंप्लीमेंट. दैट्स व्हाट यू आर गोइंग टू से इन द इंटरव्यू, इजंट इट? दैट्स अ प्रैक्टिकल वे. Will you agree with that approach?
Yes.
So what we are going to discuss here is around 5-6 techniques and also some of the other practical things. Not just model building is always the higher priority, data cleaning, later on feature engineering, different type of model validation, some problems that you may face in the real world, what are the solutions for them? Those kind of real tips and tricks that will come only by working in a company that you will get. Those points I'm trying to cover here. Okay. More than just simple theoretical knowledge. This is by no means a complete a data science course of 1 year or something. I have to admit that. This is just a course that will land you in a data scientist role that will help you to do the job. Even after getting there, you have to do the job. That will also be the message that you will getting in this course. But to become a 100% complete data scientist, at the end of this course, I'm going to give you the journey, like in the next 2 years, what you are going to learn. Because it took around 12 years for me to become a data scientist. I must say, at least you should have a 2 years plan, isn't it? Within 3-4 months, we can only learn limited ones that can really help us to, we will focus on the most important aspects.
Yes.
Sorry, a small question, sir. So in interview point of view, some recruiter is asking that what tough situation you come across and how you solved it.
So what we are going to do is, I'm going to give you some around 10 project assignments. Okay. These are some of the real projects. Okay. Or the real problems. When you are solving, you will face tough situations. Okay. And you have to share them in the interview. So the 3 to 4 years experienced guy, whatever data science roles, whatever data science tasks that he will be doing in his 3 to 4 years experience, in these 3 to 4 months, I'm going to put you through all of them. Okay. And the way you, since for those kind of questions, there are no right or wrong answers. The way you're going to present yourself is going to fetch the job or something. Okay. Those kind of questions, we have to kind of give an answer, which is a kind of encouraging a discussion rather than exact correct answer doesn't exist for those questions. Okay. Maybe in one of the projects, the data is quite large. Importing that itself, you will face a lot of issues. You can discuss that. I have a very large data set when I was working on it. The RAM was not helping me, etc., etc. You can share that. Or one of the projects, the feature engineering will be very tough. Then you will be telling the hidden patterns were there. I found it really difficult to, capture all those patterns. Those kind of things you can share. Okay. It's all about gaining the confidence. What happens is maybe in your first 3 or 4 or even first 10 interviews, you will be getting all these bouncer questions, which you have not really prepared. From the 11th interview onwards, you must be very well prepared. With every interview, you're going to get better and better and better and better. It is the 15th interview that you will be giving it with 100% conviction. You yourself will be convinced, yes, it has gone beyond 45 minutes. So somebody is interested in me. It has gone, the discussion went well. It will be that 15th interview that you will do it correctly. Until then, it will be a struggle. Okay. It happens with everyone. So what happens with a lot of students is right now they will be worrying about a lot of things. I'll be telling them, don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. Ignore that. Ignore that. Because the most biggest issue that I have seen is right now with the new students that are coming, even if I try to tell them, a lot of people, they find it very difficult to understand. Ignoring whatever is not required is very important. So when I say this is not important, ignore it, some people will not be able to do that, because that is the way that we learn. Everybody have their own style. By keeping too many things on our CV, we put ourselves in a big trouble. Because I kept it, if somebody asks about it, I'm not able to convince them. Rather than keeping few things, being 100% perfect in them will give you a higher chance. All right.